أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين ورحمة للعالمين وصلى الله على آله الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا وصيكم بعهد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله. Today's khutba has been designated by the organization known as Muslims with Disability as a campaign for awareness about disability in the Muslim communities. And so inshallah we'll be talking about it briefly in the first khutba. Let me begin by saying that when it comes to the life in this dunya, this is the life of challenges. You know, sometimes people say, you know, why do we have so many challenges? I assure you, if you have a life without challenges, it will be very boring. The worth of your life depends on how you deal with the challenges that come along your way. That is where you appreciate your own, you know, ability. And this is how, you know, the way it's said that if you buy a spade, a new one, and just hang it in your garage for years and years, don't use it, it will rust. It's only when you take it out and hit on the ground, that's where the shine will remain. And this is where your worth comes when you are faced with challenges. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam says something which is really, it was surprising for me actually when I read it first time. And I'll urge you to be patient about it and maybe review your own next 40 days. When Imam says, مَا مِن مُؤْمِنٍ إِلَّا وَهُوَ يُذَّكَّرُ فِي كُلِّ 40 يَوْمًا بِبَلَاءٍ تُصِيبُهُ. That there is not a mu'min, but that Allah will put him with a test and trial once every 40 days. إِمَّا فِي مَالِهِ, either in the matters of his, you know, wealth and, you know, his money, أو في ولده, or in case of, you know, the child, أو في نفسه, or in case of himself. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I would like to see how does he or she deal with the balā, the test and trial, فَيُؤْجَرُ عَلَيْهِ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, you know, reward that person accordingly. In Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah actually talks about five types of, you know, ibtilā and imtihān. Five types of tests and trials that people can go through. And the way he talks about it, وَلِنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ, this is from balā. And there is double emphasis in this word in Arabic. The lam is there, noon with tashdeed is there at the end. Double emphasis that verily, surely, Allah says, I'm going to put you in the state of test and trial in different ways. بِشَيْءٍ مِلَ الْخَوْفِ, you know, the situation of fear, socially or politically, you know, insecure or instable environment, wal-ju' and hunger and thirst, wa-naqsin min al-amwal, it could also be in form of the loss of your wealth, wal-anfus, or your life, which could even be illness and sickness that we go through. والثمرات. The word ثمرات means fruits, although the general translation would be fruits of your garden, but that already comes under amwal. Here it means the fruits of your life, your children. You know, وبشر الصابرين, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet that give good tiding to those who maintain sabr and patience in these states of test and trial. And this is where I think, you know, when we talk about the issue of disability of individuals, you know, we have to realize sometimes some people are very quick in judging others when they see a person is afflicted with illness or somebody in the family. You know, all other issues come up and they say, he must have committed a guna. He must have committed a sin, and so Allah is punishing him. Did you get a wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tell you that this is his punishment? No. This is where you have to realize that, you know, this is utter nonsense. To look at the challenges of somebody else and make this judgment that he or she is suffering because of having committed a sin. No, ibtilā and imtihan is there even for the good people, for the righteous people. Anbiya and a'imma also have gone through that ibtilā and imtihan. It's not because of sin. You know, everybody has different levels. And this is where we have to realize that when a person goes through the challenges, you know, especially if they are able to overcome that and also maintain sabr, this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards them with forgiveness and his mercy. And that is part of the letter, ayat in Surah Baqarah that I mentioned earlier. And so we have to realize that it's not only the person who is going through difficulty and challenges that person is being tested. Even you, the way you react in your words and behavior towards them, that is your imtihan, that is your balā. So you are okay, you know, and this is where you have to be careful about it. Ibtilā and imtihan doesn't only mean when a person is going through difficulties in illness or loss of, financial resources and things like that. It's also the behavior and reaction of people to others who are suffering is itself is ibtilā and imtihan for that person. You know, if you, and this is where it's important to learn how to react to these kinds of situations. Again, going to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam. He says, إِذَا رَعَيْتَ الرَّجُلُ قَدْ أُبْتُلِيَ وَعَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ. If you see somebody who is going through challenges, Allah has put him in challenges. While you realize that Allah has blessed you, you're free from those, you know, bala or illness or problems, then what do you do? How do you react to that? Imam says that say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma inni la askhar wa la afkhar. Wallah, I am not, you know, ridiculing this person, nor bragging about myself, walakin ahmaduku ala azimi ni'amaika alayya. Rather, I am thanking you for the great blessings that you have given on me. And so that's something we had to keep in mind, that even, you know, looking at our own situation, feeling happy about it, that's fine. You know, but do it in a way that, you know, it is considered to be appropriate. Even when we address somebody who is going through difficulties and challenges, there was a story in the life of the Prophet where once he was passing by somewhere and he saw there is a crowd there gathered, and he asked them, what is going on? And there was a person lying down on the ground by the side of the street. And when the Prophet asked what happened, he said, well, you know, this was a person who was going through epileptic or dementia situation there. And they say, oh, hadha majnoon. He's mentally, you know, he's lunatic or crazy. And the Prophet, when he looked at him, he said, he's not majnoon. He's not majnoon. Hadha al-mubtala. He has been put into ibtilā. This is his test. Don't ridicule him that in this way. If you really want to do something, help him. Even when, again, you know, similar to the words of the sixth Imam, the Prophet says, وَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ أَهْلَ الْبَلَىٰ فَحْمَدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُسْعِمُوهُمْ وَلَا تُسْمِعُهُمْ فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ يَحْضُنُهُمْ. If you see somebody who is going through ibtila and imtihan, test and trial, and you want to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't do it on their face. Because then you are saying that, you know, you are unlucky and I'm lucky. You thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not in a way that you are, in a way, putting salt into the injury of this person. And so it's very important, especially for us, you know, in our centers, in our masajid, our Husainiyas, if you see a person coming inside, and this is more important for the volunteers who are managing the crowd, that when you see a child or a family member coming with someone who is physically, you know, disabled or mentally challenged, make them, feel welcome. But do not, you know, behave in a such a way that you are, you know, there's no need to, show pity towards them, because that itself is in an indirect way of insulting them. And, you know, these days there is a lot of awareness about this. And you will see even Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is actually more than one case where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala singles out the people who have physical disabilities. Exemptions in many things like jihad, for example. One of the cases is very interesting in Surah number 24, Surah An-Nur, Ayat 61, which is talking about interaction with those who are related to you. It's a long ayat, but begins with the words, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْرَجِ حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيضِ حَرَجٌ. This is the beginning of the verse, that, you know, a person who is blind or a person who is lame, had difficulty in walking, or a person who is marig, not feeling well, there is no blame for them. For what? The ayat is very long. Basically, this is the context of this verse is that before Islam in Medina, you know, people, when they had somebody who was blind or physically disabled, when they sit down for food, they will keep them away. You know, not allow them to sit with them on the same sufra, for example. And this is where, you know, the issue comes up, that you do not shun them on the side. Include them the best way that you can. Yes, it could be challenges, you know, but then you have to deal with a case-by-case situation. The issue of even helping those who are disabled. You know, alhamdulillah, these days, even if you build any public place, there are some building regulations where they will not give you the occupancy permit until, you know, there is access for those who are handicapped or special, you know, parking facilities for them. Remember, this is not only a civic requirement, it's a religious instruction also. that we have to facilitate and make things easy for those who are physically challenged. You know, there was a person who was blind, a neighbor of the Masjid al-Nabi there. And he came to the Prophet and says, you know, I have some young people in the family who would always help me to come to the Masjid. But they are not always available. What do I do? And I would like to come and join the Salat. And the suggestion given by the Prophet was, if it's possible, tie a rope from the your door till the Masjid. Apparently it was not that far away. And use that as a way of, you know, finding your own way from home to the Masjid and back. And this is just one example that you know, helping those who have physical challenges is part of what our faith says. There is a statement from the Prophet where he says, "Man qada dhariran ila masjidihi aw ila manzilihi." If you help a blind person to coming to the Masjid or from Masjid to his home, كتب الله له بكل قدم رفعها ووضعها. For every step that this person who is helping the blind, every step that you take and put it on the ground again, the reward for every step would be itqa raqaba, as if you are buying a slave and freeing that slave in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَصَلَّتْ عَلَيْهِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ حَتَّى يُفَارِقُهُ. And the angels would be constantly asking for blessings for that person until they're separate. And so keep in mind that, you know, this is part of human challenges. Individually, collectively, and as a community, we have to think about this issue and improve ourselves as well as our behavior and attitude towards the physically disabled and even mentally challenged people are concerned. In Ahsan al-Hadith, Kitab Allah al-Aziz, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Wal Asr, Innal Insana lafi Khusr, Illa Alladhina Amanu wa Amil al-Salihat, Wa Tawasaw bil-Haqq, Wa Tawasaw bil-Sabr. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المظلمين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. In this second khutbah, I would like to talk about the current issues, just deriving one more point of reflection, that the Western politicians always preach to the rest of the world about the importance of democracy, especially freedom of speech. And it becomes even more important when they want to insult our Prophet. You know, you go to the authorities, especially in Europe, they say our hands are tied. This is our cardinal faith, you know, freedom of speech, we cannot stop people. During peacetime, you know, everything is fine. But the real worth of a society and a community is during the time of conflict. That is where really you see that people really believe in the values that they are preaching. Or is it just lip service? Or just a means of propaganda? You know, the Gaza conflict has revealed the true nature of the political elite in the West. And I'm using the word here, political elite, because we see there is a difference on the streets of the capitals of the Western countries and what the governments are saying. They are not on the same page. And it exposes their hypocrisy. Look at the media. Right in the beginning, the days of the Gaza's conflict, MSNBC basically reassigned three journalists, Muslims one, from their normal show where they were hosting. So they are not saying that, oh, we are dismissing them, or we are reassigning their duties. Yesterday, MSNBC canceled the Sunday night shows of Mehdi Hassan. And there's already a backlash against it about it, because it seems there is an attempt to silence one of the most prominent Muslims on air, because he doesn't shy away from challenging his guests, whether they are American, Europeans, or Israelis. You know, one of his latest interview with the advisor to Israeli Prime Minister, on social media, it has about 6 million views, where he actually challenges him, and this fellow on the other side was not able to respond, just went around and around. And the question was very important. He said, what if there were terrorists in a housing complex or a building in Tel Aviv? Are you going to bomb that building? Or if the terrorists are hiding in a school and the students are still there, in order to eliminate the terrorists, are you going to bomb the school? And he said, the Hamas is using civilians as the front. And he goes around and around. At the end, he said, you didn't answer my question. And it's a point of reflection. And this is his courage to be able to even, challenge his guest on that way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them more power and courage, inshallah. And it's not only the media. Even if you look at the academia, which is supposed to be a place where the scholars are free to investigate, research, and present their conclusion to their students. The latest example is the University of California. Because there were conflicts at the, not physical conflicts, but both groups from this issue of the conflict were there, having their own protest march. The president of the University of California system basically mentioned in the board meeting that we are investing $2 million for the program, where one of the points is mentioned is that so that we may teach a viewpoint of neutral history of the Middle East. The neutral history of the Middle East. So don't say who is right, who is wrong. Everybody is okay. It's very similar to the whole issue of, what happened on October 7th. Nobody wants to talk about the background. Everybody says you start with October 7th. And this is the issue. Fortunately, there are many, many people in the academia who have signed letters against their own president in that university, saying that, presenting conflicting viewpoints is an important part of history education. You cannot dictate what we are teaching. You let the professors and the lecturers, give them that freedom to do their own research. And so this is where I would like to, end with one ayat of the Qur'an, which is a challenge for the humanity, especially for Muslims. That when we deal about, dealing with situations, even if the opponent is somebody who has been unfair and unjust to us, and even if we have this level of, anger against that person, our attitude in dealing with that person should be on the basis of justice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ma'idah, this is one of the last surahs to be revealed. Ayat number 8, he says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe, kunu qawwamina lillah, shuhada'a bilqist, be maintainers of justice and the bearers of witness for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا. And do not let the hatred of a people, because of their own, you know, unjust behavior towards you, do not let the hatred of a people incite you not to be just and fair, because this is أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. This is, you know, to be just and fair, even with an enemy, is closer to this issue of piety and righteousness. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, and fear displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah is aware of what you do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all sensible human beings, especially the Muslims, the ability to live by that, you know, very noble value. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. وعلى أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها. وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليه الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما أحيى أثار البدء والطغيان هادي بأبلية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المسترشدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.